This man has very improper table manners. He is putting more and more food into his mouth and chewing it very rapidly. But even this impulsive manner of chewing is under his voluntary control. If he wants, he can slow down his pace of chewing. So chewing takes place because of voluntary muscles in the mouth. Now, post-chewing, how does the food from the mouth travel through this gastrointestinal tract into the stomach? See, a person is eating through the mouth, and then the food travels down this pipe, which is known as the gastrointestinal tract, into the stomach for digestion. So how is the food traveling downwards? Is it because of gravitational force? Because we have studied that gravitational force always tends to pull an object downward. Well, if this is happening due to gravitational force, then what happens when a person is vomiting? Because during vomiting, the passage of food takes place upwards from the stomach to the mouth. So gravitational force cannot be acting then. Well, it is not gravitational force which is causing the movement of the food from the mouth to the stomach or from the stomach to the mouth. It is actually caused due to the alternate contraction and the relaxation of this gastrointestinal pipe. The gastrointestinal pipe is alternately contracting and relaxing, and this causes the passage of food from the mouth to the stomach. Now, this passage of food is not under our control or will. So, this movement is an involuntary movement, that is, it is not within our control. So, it is governed by the involuntary muscles present in our body. Involuntary means not according to one's wish. Similarly, when a person is vomiting, the same contraction and relaxation of this gastrointestinal tract, but in the opposite direction, that is from the downwards to the upwards, causes the passage of food from the stomach to the mouth above. So, an angry man becoming red in the face, or a small little boy wetting the bed, both of these are involuntary movements. And hence, they are governed, or the muscles that are responsible for these type of movements are known as involuntary muscles. Because these movements are not within our voluntary control. So involuntary muscles are those which are not under our control, and they are present in our internal organs and vessels. So if you see involuntary muscles under a microscope, this is what you'll see. See, these are individual cells. This is an individual cell. This is another cell. Now see, these cells are spindle or boat shaped. See, they have a spindle or a boat shaped. Now notice another thing, and that is these cells do not have a striped appearance like the voluntary muscles. They do not have the alternate dark bands and the light bands. So they do not have striations on their cells. They have a very smooth appearance, and so are known as the smooth muscles. So because there are no striations on the cell, They are known as the smooth muscles. So involuntary muscles are also known as smooth muscles. Now, if you take some involuntary muscle or smooth muscle and observe under the microscope, this is what you'll see. These are individual cells. This is one cell. This is another cell. Now notice, one cell contains a large nucleus, but it is one in number. So each cell has one nucleus, and so these cells are uninucleated. Uni means one, and nucleated comes from the word nucleus. So these cells, since they have one nucleus present in their cell, they are known as the uninucleated cells. Now notice another thing. These cells are very loosely packed. There is a gap between these cells. So this is one cell, there is a gap, and there is another cell. Then there is another gap, and this is another cell. So you can also see from this microscopic view that these cells which form the smooth muscles, they are loosely packed cells. So the cells that form the smooth muscles, they are uninucleated and they are loosely packed. So involuntary muscles are those that are not under our control. They are spindle shaped or boat shaped. They do not have striations on their body and hence are also known as the smooth muscles. And they have uninucleated cells. That is, each cell contains one nucleus and they are loosely packed. The cells are loosely arranged. Now, we've often faced this phenomena, which is known as goosebumps, when we feel very cold. So, when we feel very cold, what happens is that the hair on our hands and on our legs, they raise. So, why does this happen? Well, this is because we have hair on our skin, and at the base of each hair is a small muscle which contracts when there is very cold temperature outside. And when these muscles contract, the hair rises. And this hair raising effect takes place to trap heat from outside so that our body stays warm. Now, can you tell me which muscles are responsible for this hair-raising effect or the goosebumps? Is it the skeletal muscle or the voluntary muscle? Or is it the smooth muscle, which is also known as the involuntary muscles? Well, yes, it is the smooth muscle which is responsible for this hair-raising effect. Because this entire phenomena or this entire process is not under our voluntary control. It takes place automatically when we feel very cold. Since they are not under our voluntary control, so the muscles responsible are involuntary muscles or smooth muscles.